They work with smart solutions, innovations, and applications for people, environment, and society. Their main focus is on deltas, coastal regions, and river basins. Managing these densely populated and vulnerable areas is complex, which is why they work closely with governments, businesses, other research institutes, and universities at home and abroad. As an applied research institute, the success of Deltares can be measured in the extent to which their expert knowledge can be used in and for society. For Deltares, the quality of their expertise and advice is foremost. Knowledge is their core business. All contracts and projects, whether financed privately or from strategic research budgets, contribute to the consolidation of their knowledge base. Furthermore, they believe in openness and transparency, as is evident from the free availability of their software and models. Open source works is their firm conviction. Deltares employs over 800 people and is based in Delft and Utrecht. I'm not sure about misspelling it. My pronunciation. Deltares specializes in climate change, flood risk, hydraulic engineering, integrated coastal zone management, water resources management, infrastructure, offshore warning systems, spatial planning and ecology, strategic studies, urban water management, water and soil quality, applied geosciences, groundwater quality. Now, we found out about the Sandwater and Deltares, well, actually Mary, who has done a lot of research, discovered this new concept, and we contacted them to find out if they could come. So today we have Arjen, Luigen, sorry, I can't pronounce your name, who studied coastal engineering at Delft University of Technology and has been a senior coastal engineer at Deltares for the last 12 years. One of his published articles is titled, A New Alternative to Sailing on Beaches from Sea Level Rise, the Sand Engines, which is what they're going to explain to us today. With him is Dr. Timothy Price. I can pronounce your name. he studied physical geography, coastal and river systems at Utrecht University, and is a river and coastal engineer. One of his many publications is Morphodynamic Zone Variability on a Microtidal Barred Beach, Marine Geology. I actually started reading that. It's very interesting, actually. Last but not least, the best is always at last, as they say, is Dr. Vera Vikolinen. And Vera was born in Russia. She obtained a bachelor's degree in business administration, cum laude, from St. Petersburg State Polytechnic University, and a master's degree in European studies, cum laude, from the University of Twente. She published her research results in English, Dutch, and Russian, and completed her PhD research entitled Nature at Work, the Feasibility of Building with Nature Projects in the Context of EU Natura 2000 Implementation in 2012. And she has many other publications. Welcome all three, and I'm going to pass it on to you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for inviting us. We're very delighted to be here. It's the first time in Jamaica. The last 36 hours have been amazing. So despite the rain, we love it here. Although we thought that the temperature would be a little bit higher, so maybe But you get along for long series, but anyway. We were asked to brief you a bit on the Dutch kind of pilot experiment within the building momentum concept. So we have prepared a presentation, which we'll give with the three of us. And we also have a movie for about 13, 14 minutes about the sand engine. So all in all, I think we have some material for 30, 45 minutes. If you have any short questions in between, just raise your hand. We'll give your answers if possible. Serious discussions may arise, then we'll postpone it to the end. So this is the contents of our presentation, starting with a brief introduction of the team, but you know all the details by now. The Dutch situation, where we are from, and then going to the pilot project about the scent motor, or the scent engine. Sometimes we call that differently, but it's the same. So we have a movie, and then Vera will continue with the building and engine concept. And Timothy will finalize the Nature Coast scientific program. Yeah, this is actually already said, but now it's on black and white. I'm a coastal engineer, part-time at TU Delft and Delft Harris. And I'm a postdoc looking on physical feasibilities of mega motions worldwide. Timothy is a postdoc on ecosystems, and Vera is a postdoc on governance. So, I'll take you briefly to Europe, to the Netherlands. We are a very small country, located eastward of the UK, and north of France. It's about here, but we have two large rivers, entering the sea, the coastal zone, and the river Rhine and Meuse. Those rivers have provided a lot of sand in the past, and therefore our coast is largely containing of sand, sandy beaches and dunes. It's about 350 kilometers long, but we have, let's say, straight coasts, more or less here, but also several barrier islands, and even the delta area in the south. And our sea defense is primarily made of soft defenses, meaning dunes. We have some hard defenses indicated in the black line, so these are the dikes in these estuaries. But all the yellow are all natural dunes. This is the elevation map of the Netherlands. The word already says Netherlands, so it's a low-lying country. All the bluish is below mean sea level. So 26% of Holland is actually below mean sea level. You see, we also have mountains, or hills. Our highest hill is 314 meters, somewhere in the south of Holland. But we also have some dune areas, located more or less in this area, where we are close to the coast. You see that we have a dune area which is several centimeters high. The deepest point of Holland is 6.5 meters below mean sea level. It's about this height, even higher, I think, below mean sea level. It has been there for a long time already, and this somewhere located over here. Oh, actually, where I live is right on that yellow spot. So I'm safe. Although I'm close to the coast, I'm very high. My house is on a plus 6 meters, so that's, I'm a happy man. But there are millions of people living in this area, all below mean sea level. So we need the Jews, we need the soft coast defense. This is a typical example of a photograph of the dunes with vegetation. Vegetation helps us to keep the sand in its position. If we would not have the dunes, then this blue part of Holland will be underwater. It's about 10 million people living in this bluish area. So it's of vital importance for the Dutch to keep our feet dry. Sometimes we construct some roads, some structures, of course to stabilize the beaches. But it's a very natural, let's say, exposure. Nevertheless, as I mentioned, we had two rivers entering our coasts, and those rivers provide less and less sand to the system. So it used to provide a lot of sand, but because of the human interventions upstream, less sand is provided to the coast. So we have a problem of structural erosion. That's all along the coast. On top of that, we have sea level rise. So the consequences of that is that we have structural erosion along a large part of the Dutch coast. And to solve this, we started to nourish our coast, so to replenish our coast. An example of a city which is located along the, let's say the straight coast is Egmond. And the city of Egmond used to be located here. This is a scale that's 215 meters. So the city of Egmond used to be somewhere here. It was in the 1700s. And slowly, because of the supply of sediment decreased, the coastline retreated, and the houses were rebuilt, let's say, later. And at some point in the 1990s, the Dutch government says, okay, we're not going to retreat anymore. We're going to fix the position, and we're going to maintain that position. And the way we maintain our coast is by applying sand. We do that through a beach storage vessel, where this is a dredger hopper. This vessel took sediment from further offshore, pumped it onto the beach, and with the new sand, that part of the coast is safe for future. So then the coastline does not retreat anymore. And all the houses and all the infrastructure can be maintained. A little bit history of the types of nourishment that we apply in Holland is that we started with actually applying sand high up in the profile, so on the dry land. That's called the back shore nourishment. And then in the 90s we started to apply beach nourishment. So the good thing of that is that from a recreational point of view you can directly use that beach, that new beach. And lately, about 1995, we started to implement shore phase nourishment so that we don't apply the sand on the beach itself, but we apply the sand, we dump the sand on some deeper water, and we wait for the waves to transport it up to the beach. It's a natural process. You as community, coastal community, of course recognizes that process. And over time, the waves will transport the sediment to the beach. From the beach on, in Holland, the wind transports it into the dunes. So it's all, let's say, the natural forces that are helping us to transport that sand. And the good thing, the very, very good thing, is that this is much cheaper. Because otherwise, originally you had to push up the sand. It's a very intensive process. While in the lower part, in the shore phase nourishment, you can just dump it through barges on deeper water, and the waves will transport it, will push it up to higher parts of the profile. And that's the milder wave conditions. They're not storms, but they tend to be eroded. Transport sediment for the offshore, but the milder conditions transport it up the profile. So this is a typical coastal profile in the Netherlands, where we have the dunes, we have a berg, that's our beach, in the summer, so this is the summer profile, and then in winter you get higher waves, waves up to 7-8 meters every winter, and then the waves clear this part, and they place, or they deposit the sand on some more deeper water, and they create sandbars. And then in the following season, the milder wave conditions again bring it back to the original profile. So every summer, the profile looks like this. Well, in the winter, it follows this dashed line. So that's the dynamics of the beach, at least in Holland. So if you look at this variation of the profile over the year, it's very depending on when you observe your coastline position. Right. So, in Holland, that's not about every, let's say, single day or every same day of the year. So, what we came up with is kind of a robust approach to assess the coastline position. It's not to look at the exact coastline position, but to integrate the amount of sand in a certain profile. We just measure the amount of sand between this point and that point. And then we have, say, some relations that tells us where the coastline position is at that point. Of course, 2 weeks later can be different, but this is a technique that you can apply every year that you look at sediment volumes, not so much on exact coastline positions, but sediment volumes. So that's a, let's say, understanding of the system that is required prior to what you choose as the type of nourishment. Because you need to know this behavior, this dynamics of the profile, before you place your short phase nourishment or your beach nourishment. So, as I already told, the Dutch government decided in 1990 to maintain the 1990 coastline position, and from that time onwards we nourish the Dutch coast with 6 million cubic meters a year on average. However, in 2001, to maintain that same coastline, we required 12 million cubic meters per year. So it's doubling the volume. And of course, we all know climate changes, sea level rise, but also change of the characteristics of the soils. And a committee of very wise men in Holland sat together in 2008 and looked into the future with sea level rise scenarios and made some prospects that in future, in 2050, we may have to increase our nourishment volume up to 40 million. And in the worst case, up to 85 million cubic meters. Well, where 20 years ago we started with 6, we're now, let's say, challenged to apply 85 in a very worst case scenario. Of course, that means a lot of money, but you can also think on, let's say, the methods and the techniques. How do you apply that sand? Do we continue with short phase nourishment, or are there other techniques to there's a tendency towards larger scale nourishments, which gives uncertainties, because we have no experience with that. Uncertainties on environmental effects and impacts. And at the same time, as there's a lot of people living in that same coastal area, there's a need for additional space for recreation and nature development. So, the province of South Holland, one of the provinces along the coast, has a challenge to, let's say, look for a recreational area to provide every inhabitant of that area sufficient recreational space. And these are the recreational areas that we have. Rather limited. I live about here. I can either go to the south or to the north with my bike and enter a natural area. But there's not a lot of options. So they had a challenge. How can we realize our ambition to provide every inhabitant a certain amount of recreational area in their neighborhood? And at the same time, the ministry had a challenge, already discussed a bit, on do we continue with our traditional peace nourishments or short-term nourishments, or are we looking for, let's say, an upskilled method into, let's say, localized mega nourishments? And then the ministry and the prophets both had, let's say, questions and ambition, and they sat together with other parties, of course. And they said, okay, let's try a pilot. They said, we need to nourish the coast because of safety, but at the same time, we're looking for a recreational area and nature development. So then a phase started on, okay, if we're going to look for mega nourishments or large-scale nourishments, how does that apply? There's no evidence in the world on what the shape should be. We have no experience in Holland ourselves. So with the Miracle Holding, we try to predict the development of different designs. And we started with a submerged nourishment, indicated here, and a clock formation. It's an old-fashioned clock that you probably remember, but a symmetric one. We have a hook shape, and we have the island. I'm not going to touch upon all designs, but if we look at the hook shape in the island, then this is the initial geometry. So the green means, let's say, dry land, so it's accessible by foot. Of course, the island is not. But after, with an American modeling, we can make predictions in the future. And this is after 5, after 10, after 15 years, after 20 years, that you see that the initial shape is relevant for the first years. But after that, it tends to develop to the same geometry, same bulge along the coast. So the initial shape could be important, but on the longer term it's not. And that resulted in the final design of the Zend motor. The Zend motor was approximately 2 kilometers long, longshore, sticking 1 kilometer into the sea. So this was the original beach, and this was all placed by bridges. It's a nourishment of 20 million cubic meters. It's enormous. The previous nourishment of Holland was, I think, 12 or 8 cubic, 5 million cubics. So this is by far the largest. And it's realized in 2011. And the idea behind it is that this part of the coast was nourished every 3 to 4 years. Every 3 to 4 years, 1 or 2 million cubic meters was placed. That means that the whole ecosystem, the ecology on the seabed or at the dunes, is disturbed every 3 to 4 years. So, let's say all the benthos and benthic life recovered after some while, and then the next nourishment came on top of them and probably killed them all. So, one of the ideas is that if we come and concentrate that in time and space, we're going to apply this mega nourishment, but leave it there for the next 20, 25, maybe 30 years, then the ecosystem has time to develop. And as it will change, because of the tides and the waves and the wind, it will transport the sediment along the beach, you get different shapes. So you also get biodiversity. But it means high variety in ecosystem. So it's a concentrated nourishment, scent, motor, both in time and location. So it's a surplus of scent, and it will be distributed over time. So there's no stone involved, it's all scent, there's nothing protected. And from 2011 onwards, actually nature determines its development, its shape, how fast it goes. Well, this is the presentation of the first part. We're now going to look at the movie and then continue with our next topic. Yes, question?
Is this a real photograph?
Yeah, this is a recent photograph.
Where the sand is there now, that was all water?
Yes.
And when you talk about the sand water, is it a mechanical motor?
No. Now, the term sand motor is a little bit, let's say, confusing, because there's nothing mechanical, you don't stop any fuel into this motor. But the idea is that this body of sand provides sand to the, let's say, to the adjacent coasts. And therefore, it's a kind of motor that provides fuel or sand to the coast motor in the south.
That sand came from further up the sea.
Yeah.
Not from the rivers.
Not from the rivers, beyond the minus 20 depth from the river.
And that was pumped in by a ship?
Yes. Any short questions so far?
What's the average cost per meter? So square meter of time?
The square meter. The dredges, they offered, our public Ministry of Public Works has 50 million euros available, and they asked the dredges how much cubic meters can I get for that. And then they come up with 21 million cubic meters. So that's 2.5. Euros for a cubic meter. So that's one of the cheapest deals.
Yes.
Yeah. That is cheap. Luckily, one of the reasons for that is that the port of Rotterdam just reclaimed a large part of their port into the sea. So the largest dredging vessels were available at that same time. And we said, okay, we have all our most efficient equipment available there. They could offer a lot of trust. At the same time, the Dutch Ministry of Public Works says, okay, the dredges, please indicate when in the next, like, in 2 years, you can time the creation of the sand engine yourself. So you're free with your own planning, but